It's helpful to like think about where we've been. I have all the history of video game consoles in North America in my office. And you can just look along the table and go, wow, the guys that were winning yesterday are not winning today. The biggest IPs of the last generation did not even exist two generations before. What does that tell us about who might win tomorrow? Video games are my entire life, and my partners are the same way. So every time we win at something, we just kind of put it all back in and see what else we can do. It's a vicious cycle, but it's exciting. And so every time we go in it with this hope and wish to just try to make people feel good, that's how we fill the gap in whatever's wrong with us. We believe in everything we get behind, but you know, sometimes we'll make stuff and people are like, that is terrible. And we're like, God, we really tried. We just wanted to make you happy.
Most times, and I suspect this is true of most studios, the thing you set out to do is never exactly the vision of what lands. Afterwards, people find themselves excited to move on to another thing. It can be anywhere from, that was fun, I can't wait to revisit that someday, all the way through to rats leaving a ship. You know, people just want to get the fuck out. I don't even care if it's good, I just want it out. I just want it done. For Borderlands, it was the first time where when that game shipped, people were excited about making more Borderlands.
Well, when we released Borderlands 2, there's a lot of catharsis, right? Because, man, we kill ourselves. It's good that we get occasional victories. We felt really good. The critics loved it. Gamers showed up. We kind of broke that third level where you're actually reaching normal people. You know what I mean? Like normal people that don't play a lot of games. I mean, it's the best-selling game we've ever made. Apparently, it's the best-selling game 2K's ever published, too, so that's really cool, right? There's a point where it's like, okay, what should the next Borderlands game be?
Where should it be? Who are the characters? Like, immediately, your mind wants to get into that.
Well, there's this kind of knowledge that, like, if you're gonna do something that's called Borderlands 3, and it's gonna be done in this next-generation environment, we imagine what that might be, and it's frankly, it scared us. It's like, that's so crazy and so big, I'm not sure we can succeed. Meanwhile, how much Borderlands is there in us?
Certainly we could do, I wouldn't say the easy, because the next Borderlands is going to be a ball buster, I imagine, but we could do the obvious thing, but you don't always have the opportunity to have a baby. And so we sort of took it upon ourselves to see if we could be creative again in the way that we had been back for Borderlands 1.
Just like all of us are as gamers, there's so many different choices we want to make, you know, when we play games. Imagine what it's like for a creator. When you commit to something that you're working on, you're going to be doing that for a long time, sometimes years. It's really healthy for us to test ourselves and to try different things thematically. When it comes to like committing our full force and like the majority of our mind share, we should do it towards something that's never been done before. Christoph, you know, the guy that runs all of 2K, he's the president of 2K. He and I sat down a lot and we're talking about like next moves and stuff. And we looked at the business case together for more Borderlands and thought about the different scenarios. And we looked at the business case together for new IP. And I think he gets it too, that like, if you're gonna bet on the future, you gotta bet on new. You know, he's smart enough to know, look, I can try to force him into just being only the Borderlands studio, but what that'll really mean is Randy will just sign up with somebody else and then 2K won't be our publisher anymore, right? So it's like the better move is like, where's the passion momentum gonna take him anyway? Let's back that. And I love him for it. And he knew that's where our passion was gonna be. And he also knows, you know, we ship games, we're gonna figure this out and we're gonna do something. And it's like, if you bet on what they want to do and where their passion and momentum is, then he knows we're gonna kill ourselves. And I had the idea. Really, the root of the idea is it sucks to go online and play a competitive FPS game because if you don't have awesome skill, it's a miserable experience. So the thought was, though, if you can layer the competitive game on top of a cooperative game, like if there's a basically like a campaign style scenario where there's AI and there's a game that you have to beat, and if you have that as the foundation and then put other players on both teams and like have, so both sides are trying to do the same thing against each other, like that was the root of the idea.
Dota must have been a reference point for that kind of thing.
Well, it wasn't, here's one of, a couple of those guys, we went to the BlizzCon. They had the Blizzard Dota. It was a mod of StarCraft 2. And when we were talking about this like a couple of months before some of us went to BlizzCon together and noticed that. Dota and League, they're totally different genre. Like they're like strategy games almost, right? Where you're top down. But it does validate that instinct.
The creative producer for Borderlands 2 as it ended was Randy Barnell, and he succeeded so well in that role that it was very easy to imagine him in the future moving into a creative direction role.
Randy Barnell was there in Ground Zero. I told him about my idea and we batted it around, and it stuck.
He and I sat down, and you know, we were looking at kind of what we built before. We're thinking about the parts that we wanted to put in. You know, start with the shooter. But Gearbox always has this, I don't know whether it's insanity or whether it's genius, we have to kind of blend things together. We know that we like the RPG loop, we like the leveling up, we like the loot, we like getting stuff, we like fiddling with our characters and customizing it. And we love that promise in Borderlands. You know, Borderlands was the 87 bajillion guns. And we're like, what if we took that and started thinking about that in other aspects? You know, what if we made a lot of characters? What if we really doubled down on that promise?
One of the reasons we took on this project is we noticed we had that strength. We felt good about our ability to create characters, but we had never done this much lifting in characters.
But we started prototyping and playing with that, you know, using existing technology and existing content as a foundation.
I think this model could work within the Borderlands universe.
Was there
any temptation to brand it just to help it out a little bit?
We talked about that.
Okay.
Yeah, and Christoph and I talked about that. And we talked about that inside of Gearbox. And while the brand would have helped it got more attention and may have like made it easier to pre-sell and all that, it would have come at a cost at the liberties we have to tune the universe around what the game begs for and demands. Once we said, look, it's all about the variety of characters, we need a universe that is even wider than Borderlands in terms of what can possibly be playable. There's things we can't do without like people that love Borderlands, including us, going, come on, really?
We wanted to open it up. Yeah. You know, I mean, we wanted a new set of boundaries that would allow for that expression of even further diversity of characters.
Also, just creating new IPs is kind of fun.
The first room where we started brainstorming story, there was like six guys in there. You know, that was a fun room. And like, how long does it take to get six guys around? It's like, hey, dream up a general who, what, why, where, when premise for a backstory. You can have an idea in 15 minutes. Mm-hmm. Why were we in there for 3 months?
Right.
You don't want to see all the ideas we threw away. When the Last Star concept emerged, it was like, holy crap. There's going to be a time where, as all the stars burned out, there's going to be one star left. There will be a Last Star. And so that Last Star becomes the most valuable energy source that it was ever known. And you can think of every species, every possible thing that ever emerged on any system will eventually gutterball around that Last Star. So you're gonna have all kinds of crazy shit all coming together and being in the same spot. And they're all gonna have opinions about that.
You know, with Battleborn, we've designed this universe that lets us kind of explore whatever we want. This is a game where you have an elf with a bow, with a guy in battle armor with an assault rifle, you know, fighting a samurai warrior with swords that sucks your life away. You know, there's a lot of different things that we can put in the game, and each one of those characters can be a really great experience into itself.
When we figured that out in the room, we're like, holy crap, this is a science fiction construct, a concept that's actually never been used before. If it has, we don't know. But this idea is like, holy, how could we have been the only ones to come up with this? That doesn't make any sense. There's so many dudes that have been writing stories and dreaming up shit for a long time.
We're talking the end of the universe as we know it, the Last Star and all that. But it's really hard, you know, with people like John Mulkey in the studio and all of us who worked on Borderlands, we have that humor that's just kind of in us and it seeps out. Early project, I think we wanted it to be more serious, and as we got going, it's just too hard not to get some of that humor and some of that amusement back in it.
And we're working on this, it's like, what's going to be the fun thing that we can do, you know, and we'll talk about characters and different things we can do, and we'll all get excited about, you know, oh my God, that's ridiculous, we totally have to do that.
You know, you go through several phases of project every time that a new IP comes. You know, it's really exciting at the beginning. For the first 2 or 3 months, it's completely blue sky dream. You put everything on the whiteboard and you imagine all of this, and the producers come in and they tell us what we can't do. I'm kidding. We have this moment that we dream. You go through a couple of early points of prototypes and get some successes, and those are really exciting. And there's a couple of really rocky points right there in the early part, and it's been true for every time that I've done this on a project. That process of discovering that, you know, a particular design is not good or not great or not where you want it to be, it'd be pretty painful, you know, and it creates some, you know, we have a lot of passionate people. Passionate people can butt heads and all of that.
There's actually no vector I could think about within the project that isn't more ambitious than anything we've done in the past. We're really not phoning in anything.
Battleborn is, by a long shot, the biggest game Gearbox has ever made. Battleborn alone is probably larger than everything we did in the first 10 years of our existence added together. Now, I'm just guessing, I haven't actually mathed that out, but it feels about right.
Challenge number one is brand new platform.
There's just a lot more fidelity and like more animation. When you're playing like Miko and like you see just all the different ways he throws out, like, and the way the special moves work, how much animation and content is just in one character relative to a Borderlands 2 character?
So that, from a production side, that's a huge challenge. That's been a big one for us. Yeah, we're going into new waters that I've never been in, so I won't be surprised if we hit some rocks. No.
But what's cool is, and this always happens at Gearbox, and I think it's really neat, the projects have that moment where they finally come together.
It's really fun right now already. You know, we have reached that point where the vision comes together and coalesces, and everybody can look at it and go, oh, okay, I see where we're going. This works. Sweet. Let's feed the beast and, you know, let's expand it and make it awesome.
And once that kicks in, then there's like an explosion that happens in the week or two afterwards. You know, then all of the people are like, we get it. We get the vision. We're on board. We believe in it. And you see a whole studio, a whole team full of people really inspired, and all the great art and all the great features and design work just blossoms out of that. Borderlands and now Battleborn to me have been just, these are dream projects in some ways, because I get to, you know, be a part of that process that influences and creates and dreams up those wacky and crazy ideas, and then work with a team that can put that finesse on it.
You've heard Randy Bardnell talk about his game, there's fire in his eyes. That's actually the exciting part.
The industry and media and entertainment in general has a terribly short memory. You are your last product. Most people, oh, those are the Borderlands guys, and if we do anything different from that, like, who knows what the hell's gonna happen, right? And then, like, before Borderlands, oh, those are the Brothers in Arms guys. And before Brothers, oh, those are the guys that do all the Half-Life games. Right. You know, it's like...
I mean, you don't think you're known as the Aliens guys?
Now? Yeah, I mean, in some people, maybe. I love the fact that we got to screw around in the Aliens universe. Mm-hmm. I still can't believe that we were even trusted to do it. I think a lot of other people might agree with that. It's kind of fun. It's kind of fun to think about how the creator affects the promise.
I imagine that come years from now, the brand that will be most attached to Gearbox will be Battleborn.
Seriously?
No, absolutely. No doubt. I think this will be unexpected. I think the world is excited and expecting us to have another Borderlands sequel coming out. I'll be personally proud to be able to say, we're going to do something that surprises you. We're going to do something brand new that you will have never have been able to see before.
I think people are going to be surprised if the Vault Hunters don't make an appearance in this game. You realize it.
Interesting.
That's an interesting concept. I won't say that we haven't talked about it, but it's really important that Battleborn first is its own universe. And that it has its own tone, it has its own style and all of that, and it can grow its legs. But it is a universe, you know, it's a vast universe with who knows what. It's set way, way, way in the future, you know. So, you know, I can't say that wouldn't ever happen, but it's hard to... Borderlands is such its own thing, so it'd be interesting to see, you know.
But Duke fits right in, right?
Gonna be on the box cover.
Right, sure.
What about the people who are gonna be bummed out that you guys aren't working on Borderlands 3?
Borderlands 3 will happen.
100%?
Asteroids could hit, you know. Gearbox is not leaving Borderlands behind in any sense of the word.
I mean, it's kind of beloved at Gearbox, you know. We're working on the pre-sequel right now. Mm-hmm. Not me, but, you know, other people at Gearbox. And you're going to see, I think, more and more and more of that come out. It'll be a bit, but...
Everybody will be excited. We'll be very excited, you know. And we'll have learned things through Battleborn and, you know, all the other games that come out between here and then. Like, that stew will be all the better. We'll have better ingredients. We'll have better people. You know, all that stuff will exist.
Right now, we have a huge amount of investment of mindshare and people and commitment towards Battleborn. And we have a lot of minds on Borderlands. The pre-sequel is terribly exciting to us, and 2K Australia is killing it. And we've got a couple of minds on Homeworld, and we've got a few things going on in other directions. I have said in the past that there's another original IP that we're pretty sure will become a thing that we announce. We're a long way away from announcing that. It could get canceled, it could get turned into something else again. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't want to make the mistake of announcing things too early. There's still people asking me about Heat, for God's sakes.
So, the great-great-grandchild of Furious 4 is another big project that's working on?
There's elements of it in almost everything we're doing, actually, because there were some cool technology and some things we discovered in Game Loop. But I wouldn't think about that as like a discrete thing anymore. So yeah. Just diffuse that into its DNA has affected everything we're doing, and that's probably the best way to think about it. Brothers in Arms has a thread, and there's some things that we'll get to at some point that we'll talk about. But in Gearbox, man, I feel like we're still just getting started. Like, there's so much we know can be done as technology develops and as our expertise develops and even as trust develops, like as we figure out more and more about what we're good at and what we're not good at and how our partners relate to that and how our customers relate to that. Like, we're still figuring things out. We have a lot to do. We have a lot to do. Like, there's so much that I feel like is not even touched yet that has to be done.